Honorable Commissioner, I must say that since we go to the state, some days back now, running to 1 week, we have seen quite a lot of projects going on here and there. And I'm not talking about Kure alone, you know, or Kitipupa, Ondo, and so on and so forth. And the pertinent question that came to our minds as a television crew is, where is the government getting funds to do all this? Because we could see government in action. In Ondo State, we seem not to see any limit. Can you tell us, what's the secret? Have you been able to actualize all the things on ground?
Thank you for that observation and the question, which I believe is very relevant. Mr. Governor, when he was sworn in on the 24th of February 2009, promised that he was going to work for the people of Ondo State. Okay. And on the constitution of his cabinet, he made it absolutely clear that there would be zero tolerance for corruption and frugal spendings. It then meant that we had to look at expenses in general. He put a limit to recurrent expenditure. Because he said he wants to come running immediately, and that the state had suffered in the past from infrastructural development. He thus said that not less than 50% of the state resources must be channeled into infrastructure. So that made up for a total paradigm shift in the structure of funding for the state. In the past, the structure had been such that recurrent expenditure, and like you know, recurrent expenditure essentially is what you spend on a day-to-day basis to run the administration. On the other hand, the capital expenditure maintains permanence. It builds roads, it builds hospitals, it build schools,
capital
and
project.
All of these capital projects. So the focus shifted immediately, and we then started channeling funds into development of capital projects.
Okay, my other question, Honorable Commissioner, I can't round up this expose on you without necessarily asking you a question that is very, 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 very key on internally generated revenue. How are you, how would I put it now? What efforts are you making in ensuring that you improve on your IGR?
Again, we also analyzed the funds that we had on ground. And we also looked at the projection of funds from federal sources and from our internally generated revenue. Of course, he had a very clear vision of his mission for the state. And he told us in very clear terms the kind of projects he wanted to put on ground. So we all were to look at his area of emphasis, and we were to draw plans. And at the Ministry of Finance, we broke down all of these projects into funding needs, and we did a projection. And when we did this projection, we found out that at some point in time, there will be gaps in our funding needs. And at that time, we were looking at about 2 years into the administration, we would need additional funds, quite apart from what we had and what we would get from federal sources. We looked at the various options of funding, and we decided, because of course, I mean, you could go to the money market. The problem of the money market, of course, is that the funds are short tenured, and the interest rates are generally high. You know,
sure.
The option of the foreign market, you could face devaluation, which indeed we had faced in the last 2 years. In the last 2 years, today Naira is at about 161 Naira 50 kobo.
Sometimes 162.
Sometimes 162 to a dollar. Mm-hmm. At the time this administration was sworn in, the official rate was less than 150, which then means that technically there has been a devaluation in currency.
Sure.
So if you borrow from foreign sources, you would be hit when you are repaying. So the more obvious solution was to borrow from the local market on a medium stroke long-term basis at a fixed rate. So we were left with the option of going to the bond market. Let me say that, of course, there are challenges in going to the bond market.
Oh, really?
The federal government bond is going for 17.25%. We have been able to raise money at 15.5%. You know, and that tells you the prudence, you know, that we have in Ondo State. But the thing that, I mean, our greatest joy, of course, is that the market has confidence in us. Now we are in the market, we are subject to international standards, we are subject to international practice. And that for us in Ondo State is a major plus. I also need to say that up until now, we have not delayed payment to any contractor. And that is why, if you observe, all our projects are going on at a fast pace.
We couldn't see any abandoned projects.
No, none at all. None. Every project that we have inherited, we have continued, and we have also added many more projects.
Well, Commissioner, we need to round up here. Time is not on our side. We wish you and the entire cabinet of Governor Olusegun Mimiko continued success. We're still looking at what's going on in Ondo State. People have been saying in Ondo State, government is working. And we've been here for a few days now and talking with all the senior officials of government complimenting the activities of Governor Olusegun Mimiko. So now I have with me the pleasure of speaking with the Attorney General, Commissioner for Justice of Ondo State, Eyitayo Jegede, a senior advocate of Nigeria. And the very first question I have for him is wanting to know the activities of his ministry, how his ministry has been contributing their own quota to the development that we see in Ondo State. You're welcome, Honorable Commissioner.
Thank you very much, madam.
So good to be here.
Thank you.
Can you tell us what your ministry have been doing since Governor Mimiko came into being today?
Personally, it's been very exciting. Exciting because my first time in public office here. And when we came in, we found out that there's a lot to be done. When we came in, we found out that there's no court of appeal here, and I believe we deserve it. We made a case for a court of appeal, Judicial Division of Court of Appeal in Akure, Ondo State. A year down the line, precisely 2010, we came in 2009.
Yeah.
We have established in Akure, Ondo State, a Judicial Division of the Court of Appeal up and running. Thereafter, we also believe that we need to have a national industrial court. We made a case for it. As I speak with you today, we have a judicial division of the national industrial court here in Akure. We provided a temporary office, and we also provided a permanent site for the complex, eventually when the permanent site is going to be constructed. Now, we also found out that Ondo State was created in 1976. 34, 35 years down the line. no government. And we've had about six or seven successive governments, both military and civilian. No effort has been made. If such was made, it was not successful, to codify the entire laws that we have in the state. And we found a need to review the laws of Ondo State generally. I'm happy to tell you that 2011, 2 years after we came into office, we were able to review and revise the entire laws of the state, and we codified them in four volumes. September 2011, the laws of Ondo State, revised laws of Ondo State, came into operation. And we believe that this is the best way. We've also ensured, coming back to the ministry itself, that we need to enlarge the personnel, the professional legal practitioners who are in the ministry. We came in, we met about 36 lawyers on ground. And ours basically is a service ministry. Okay. We take care of the government house, we take governor's office, we take care of all the ministries, legal advice and appearing in court. We draft bills, we offer advices, we prepare agreements and the rest of it. So we're a little bit short-staffed. As I speak with you now, we have brought in additional 30 legal practitioners. So as I speak with you, we have about 65 lawyers in the Ministry of Justice. We also looked at the judicial sector. And we believe that there's need also at the lower bench to increase the personnel. We met 18 magistrates on ground. As I speak with you now, we have doubled the figure. Not only did we double the figure, we also made provisions for them, for their comfort and a good enabling environment to enable them to perform the functions of the office creditably well. Now let me talk a little bit about bills, about the laws. We've enacted laws which we think are critical to development. We have the laws in respect of confidential inquiry into maternal and children's death. Huh. It's something that has not been done before.
That excites me as a woman and a mother.
Because we are interested in having a data collection backed by law of the mortality rates, those who die during childbirth,
through pregnancy
and the rest of them. And in that law, it's compulsory that in cases of death during childbirth, such death must be reported and recorded. If it is not, there's a punishment for it. We've also ensured that we have enabling legislation that will drive our development. We established direct labor agency by law. Our direct labor scheme is the pivot of our development plans. You go around and you see all the markets in place, you see the parks, you see some other structures.
Even the roads.
Yes, we have the roads there. But the basic construction of the buildings have been done majorly by our direct labor agency established by law. We're working on another law now, compensation for victims of crime. It's not been done before. There's no comprehensive legislation on victims of crime. I'll give you examples. You have robberies all over the place.
Yeah.
Along the line, you find people losing their lives. Robbers come into a bank, shoot at people who have come to collect money.
Sometimes at the bank officials.
Sometimes at the bank officials. It is not the fault of those who were the victims. Maybe it's the fault of the system. So the government owes a responsibility to all those victims of crime. And we're doing the extraordinary because we believe that we've always focused on crimes, on punishment. Nobody has given a thought to the victim of the offense. We are working on a law now to compensate all victims of crime where we found such situations demanding of compensation. It was an exciting moment in the school. And my colleagues say, look, it's not been done before. I said, no, doesn't mean you cannot do it. We're working on it. So these are legislative interventions deliberately created to propel governance and satisfy our people. And when I look back and I see what we have done and what we're still doing, I get excited. It's an opportunity, real opportunity.
Real, real opportunity. Well, another question that readily comes to my mind, AG, and knowing too well that as a senior advocate of Nigeria and the commissioner in charge of a service ministry, a ministry that touches all other ministries, really, when they have cases and all that, your legal advisors will be the ones to see what goes on and how to handle it. Could you tell us in a holistic manner, and looking at the fact that you were from the private sector before you came to the government. Candidly speaking, how would you assess Governor Mimiko's three-year administration?
I will try not to be a judge in my own court.
Because I'm part of this candidly speaking.
But I tell you straight away that what is happening is extraordinary. In the sense that you have a governor that is connected to the people 3 years down the line. And people have seen that their lives have changed. I'm particularly interested in areas like agriculture, in education, in health sector. And I'll tell you what has happened. Governor Mimiko, by vision, deliberately, has taken a position to, one, provide food security. Secondly, provide employment, all through farming and agriculture. And he has established farm settlements. In order, for instance, you have graduates who are there, settled there, living there, engaged in farming, in poultry, in farming, in fish farming, and the rest of it. And when I see what is happening there, I get excited. Get excited because I know there's food security. I also get excited because I know that there's employment for the people. And for me, the myriad of people are graduates that you have looking for job all over the place is sometimes embarrassing.
It is.
Very embarrassing.
It is.
And I think it's a security problem. So a governor that has been able, or a government that has been able to address that has done very well, in my view.
I'm told that these farmers also have access to computers, internet.
They do.
So they're not missing anything.
They do. They live in a city. That's why we call it a farm complex. Because whatever you need actually is for your convenience. You need to work, you need to relax. And in terms of work, they'll be there to work. In terms of relaxation, they also have access to what will make
them
their lives exciting. Mm. Now, coming to education, when I see the kind of structures that we have now, dotting all over the place, we call them model schools, model primary schools. In terms of beauty, special to behold. And I've traveled a little bit. And what I see here are things that you really see in terms of solidness of the structure, in terms of the ambience, in terms of the beauty, in terms of the convenience. It's special. And I think we are setting a standard here. And in terms of institutions also, this government has created the agency that will also control and regulate what happens in the educational sector. The inspectorate of the old are now here. For me, that is key. And coming to health, I'm excited that our people are having the best of healthcare. And we're also accommodating those who come from our neighboring states.
So not solely Ondo State.
Yes, we don't really discriminate. As a lawyer, I will not allow that. And we have found out that those who are outside there, deserving of good healthcare, we always look for it. And what we have found, what we've provided, is a good healthcare at no price in our mother and child hospital. That, for me, is very exciting.
Thank you so much, Honorable Commissioner. I must say, we still have some days to spend here. We're not tired of the things we're seeing. In actual fact, we ask ourselves, do we have enough time to see all the numerous projects on ground? We must say it's exciting to us, and it's quite incisive. We wish you and the entire cabinet of Governor Mimiko continued success.
I must thank you for your interest in Ondo State.
Thank
We're
you
happy
too.
To have you around. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Yeah. My name is Adokun Oluwaseye. I'm the one of the supervisor working in Greece in Farm City, Ore. This is one of the good projects from Governor Olusegun Mimiko has been doing. In this session, we have 250 ponds. In each pond, we have 2,500 fish in each pond. Each pond belongs to each one participant in this state. This is one of the projects that help a lot of young graduates that are looking for the white collar job. We give them to manage at the end of the day. If they sell, the profit of the profit of the project is be given to the participants that hold each pond in this session. Then we have a dam that feed this pond through gravity. There's no need of pumping machine, no need of anything. We do it, I mean, just open the tap, then the water flow gravity to feed each pond in this session. So in this session, we have about 2,000 hectares of land that we have in the agri village here. We divide it into arable session, poultry session, then fishery session. This is the session that we are poultry fishery session in this place.
The one of the project of Dr. Olusegun Mimiko, one of the initiative of Dr. Olusegun Mimiko, where he employed over 300 participants as a participant ownership scheme, in which we rear bears in this department, because we have about three departments in this place. We have arable, we have fishery, we have poultry. So I happen to be the governor of the poultry, and this is the areas where we learn about how to rear bird. We have about two types of rearing bird. We started from deep litter system, and now we are in cage. The experience has been so interesting. We learned how to fascinate, how to market our products. So a lot of experience we had with our customers. So they called me daily and I called them, and it has been so interesting since the inception. So we have been here for almost about 10 months now. This project has helped us a lot. Particularly, it has helped me a lot because I've graduated over, let me say, about 3 years now, and I've been searching for a job, and there's no job anywhere. But Governor Mimiko has initiated this project and has engaged me and some of our colleagues too. So we have engaged, we have something in doing. And it has helped us a lot, even for us not to be looking for white collar job where it's nowhere to be found now. So it has helped me in that area. And that is the reason why my life is changing now.
In this session, we have 1.5 million seedlings in this session. 1 million seedlings from Malaysia, 500,000 seedlings from NIFO in this session. So in this session, the total acreage that's going to cover this farm is 7,500 hectares. That is going to cover 1.5 million seedlings that we are raising in this session. In this session is one of the programs that's going to support the unemployment in this state. This project will cover at least 3,000 youths that have interest to grow palm business. At least in this session, if you have 7,000 hectares of land, at least each participant will have 2.5 hectares of the land. At least total together, we have 3,000 youths that go to occupy, that go to benefit in this session. Also, we also have a program which we call outgrower scheme, which we go into the people and meet the farmers that have interest to grow palm, to use palm as a palm business. We're going to invite them, teach them how to plant, give them the necessary information about the palm, then give them the palm free of charge if they have money to go. In time of a youth employment, we are going to establish palm for them, give them the land, give them the palm, teach them, train them how to manage the palm at the end of the day. As you can see, the cry of there's no job in this state is going to be eradicated through this program.
I thank all of you, I thank God Almighty for today. I want to pledge before you today that we will continue to work for you. God bless you all. Thank you very much.
Those of you that have challenged me, go to Ondo State and see government working. I've been here. I've seen for myself. And for those that have not visited Ondo State, I need to challenge you. I remain your uncle, Omotayo Matusho. It's a continuous one because everything that's happening in Ondo State, we couldn't bring them to you in one 30-minute package. So make sure you join a date with us next week, same time, on the continuation of government that is working in Ondo State under Governor Olusegun Mimiko. Thank you very much. God bless you.